Ethereum, the world's second largest crypto after Bitcoin, is back to all-time high.
There's two kinds of average people. There is the average person who has already heard of Bitcoin, and there's the average person who hasn't.
Traditional investors now have a clean way in through spot ETFs, and Washington, under the Trump administration, has signaled a friendlier stance toward digital assets.
But I pledged that we would bring back American liberty and leadership and make the United States the crypto capital of the world.
The result? Fresh attention, fresh capital, and a network people are building on again.
And actually, the largest beneficiary of the Genius Act is Ethereum.
Ethereum is the preferred choice for Wall Street.
But behind the charts is a very particular kind of leader. Not a command and control CEO, but a systems thinker who leads with writing, code, and persuasion. His idea of leadership is to set clear principles, design good defaults, then get out of the way. So the community, not the founder, owns the wins. If you want to understand why investors, companies, and builders now see Ethereum as infrastructure you can actually build on, you need to meet the person who lead it all. This is the entrepreneurial story of Ethereum founder Vitalik Buterin. Vitalik was born in 1994 near Moscow in the newborn Russia, but soon he had to leave his country of origins. At six, his family moved to Canada, new language, new culture. Surrounded by a family of technologists, young Vitalik quickly revealed himself as a child prodigy with an extraordinary aptitude for math and computers, and it wasn't exactly the easy childhood narrative. He once described those years as feeling abnormal, the kid others called a math genius, while he wished he could just be normal. The move also deepened his sense of isolation. Precocious and introverted, he was coding inside Microsoft Office by age 12 and never felt at ease in crowds. At 17, his dad, also a programmer, introduced him to Bitcoin. Vitalik got soon very interested in the blockchain technology and began writing about it, earning 5 Bitcoins per article for early blog posts at Bitcoin Weekly. Back then worth only a few dollars, today a small fortune.
So I heard about Bitcoin for the first time in maybe February 2011. Eventually, I found a guy who was willing to pay me 5 Bitcoins per article for writing articles for his Bitcoin blog.
At 18, he co-founded Bitcoin Magazine and became its lead writer, learning the landscape by explaining it. Writing helped him connect the dots into a vision few others could see at the time. He sees the power of a blockchain, but his mind keeps asking the same question. Why only money? Why not everything that needs trust? 2 years later, the idea finally forms into words. He wants simply a more general blockchain, a place where developers can build anything, agreements, markets, organizations, without asking for permission. On a 2013 trip through the Bitcoin world, he realizes the Bitcoin blockchain won't fulfill this vision. So he starts writing, putting down his innovative ideas. That November, at just 19, Vitalik Buterin published the Ethereum white paper. He will later summarize the core thesis in plain language. In the white paper, he introduced a bold idea, a new blockchain, Ethereum, a platform where decentralized applications, or dApps, could run on smart contracts. If Bitcoin had proved that decentralized money could exist, Ethereum declared that blockchains could be much more. Instead of building a separate blockchain for every new idea, Vitalik imagined one universal platform. A world computer, as it came to be called, programmable, open, and limited only by the imagination of its users. At first, even Vitalik underestimated what he had started.
When I wrote the November white paper, my plan was still that this would be a side project that I would quickly get done over a couple of months and then go back to university. And of course, that ended up not happening.
The white paper spreads. Developers notice. Entrepreneurs notice. The prospect of a world computer feels both impossibly grand and weirdly obvious. Of course, the internet should have a neutral, programmable settlement layer. The team that soon grow around him is eclectic and brilliant. Within months, 8 founders are sharing an Airbnb in Switzerland and arguing about what Ethereum should be. By early 2014, developers and dreamers rallied around the project. Vitalik and a small team, including Gavin Wood and Joseph Lubin, raised $18 million through one of the first major ICOs, selling Ether to fund development. Less than 2 years later, in July 2015, the Ethereum mainnet went live, a functioning network where anyone could deploy code that would run exactly as programmed on a global decentralized system. The excitement was palpable. Applications bloomed on this new world computer. Developers started creating tokens, decentralized exchanges, games, all kinds of experiments, right on Ethereum. Many of the ideas Vitalik had outlined as possibilities in the white paper, like tokens, stablecoins, even decentralized autonomous organizations, began to appear in reality. Ethereum was proving its worth as a fertile ground for innovation. Vitalik, who once thought he'd finish this project and return to college, instead found himself leading a rapidly growing ecosystem.
Saw the amount of attention and interest that we got in January, and we realized, like, this is something a lot of people are putting their hopes into. This deserves a much more serious job.
But suddenly, something in the midst of all the excitement interrupts the enthusiasm in the Ethereum world. But now, just a quick reminder. If you're enjoying this story, hit the like button and subscribe. It really helps us bring you more stories of visionary founders and keeps this series growing. And if there's a story you'd love to see next, drop it in the comments. We read them all. Now let's get back to where we left off. In early 2016, the DAO, an automated venture fund smart contract, raised roughly $150 million worth of Ethereum, about 14% of all Ether then in circulation, through a crowdfund. But what is the DAO? Picture a normal investment fund. People put in money, a small group decides what to back, a treasurer wires payments, lawyers and administrators keep score. It's slow, it's human, it runs on trust. The DAO tried a different playbook. Using Ethereum, it replaced a lot of that human work with a public program that anyone could see. Instead of a treasurer sending wires, the code held the money. Instead of a boardroom vote behind closed doors, token holders voted on chain. When a proposal passed, the program released funds automatically. No office hours, no gatekeepers. The rules were the rules for everyone, in the open, 24/7. On June 17, 2016, an attacker found a flaw. Think of a cash machine that lets you press withdraw again before it updates your balance. If you're quick, it keeps paying. Using that kind of loop, the attacker drained roughly 3.6 million ETH into a child wallet controlled by them. The money wasn't gone yet. It was time-locked for about 4 weeks, but the alarm bells were deafening. The community's experiment in decentralized governance quickly collapsed.
I pinged the core developers and I asked, hey, is this normal? At first I was thinking, okay, the alternative is unthinkable. There has to be a reasonable explanation for this. The developers looked at it, and over the next half hour, as more and more people came online and started chattering with each other, it became clear that the unthinkable has actually happened.
The hack plunged Ethereum into a moral and technical dilemma. The DAO held a hefty portion of the network's Ether, and its failure threatened Ethereum's credibility. On one side stood the principle that code is law. Whatever the smart contract did, no matter how devastating, was written, and for that, true. On the other, many felt the ecosystem should rescue innocent investors. Vitalik urged open debate. Eventually, the community drafted a fork. They would change the protocol to effectively reverse the hack. The majority of the community wanted to interrupt the Ethereum blockchain, creating two distinct chains that would have operated independently one from the other. But not everyone agreed. As Buterin observes, those who chose to revert the DAO losses became today's Ethereum chain, while the minority who stayed on the original, unaltered blockchain became Ethereum Classic.
And so there was this kind of split in the community. Right, a portion of the community did not download these code patches and implement the fork, and they just said, we will continue running our old chain. And the old chain has since then been called Ethereum Classic, and it runs to this day.
The fallout was brutal. At once, the DAO tested Ethereum's governance model and proved the community's resilience. In the end, although the fork was adopted on July 2016, Vitalik cautioned that hard forks should not be taken lightly, representing an intricate split in the community ideology. The DAO episode taught the industry a sobering lesson about security and trust. Even the boldest experiments can fail spectacularly. But Ethereum survived. By embracing transparency in its deliberations and admitting its unthinkable flaws, the project emerged stronger. After the DAO, something counterintuitive happened. The builder community didn't retreat. It exploded. Experiments multiplied. DeFi wasn't a thought experiment anymore, it was shipping. NFTs went from obscure to mainstream, and Ethereum, still a scrappy world computer, started to look like critical internet infrastructure.
NFTs were a big one. I was not really expecting anything like NFTs at all.
Those years in the 2020s remade the network. Usage surged. Whole financial primitives, stablecoins, lending markets, on-chain exchanges, moved from whiteboards to everyday tools. Layer 2s matured, pushing throughput up and fees down. But the same momentum created new problems. Congestion, speculation, culture wars over values. By spring 2021, Ether's price crossed $3,000, and the headlines called him the world's youngest crypto billionaire at 27. Then came a very public stress test of his personal ethics. In May 2021, meme coins were roaring. Without asking, Shiba Inu's creators had sent a huge share of Shiba token to Vitalik's wallet, making him, overnight, a kind of unelected king. He refused the role. He donated roughly $1 billion worth to India's COVID relief and burned most of the rest. Time put him on the cover. The Prince of Crypto has concerns. His worry wasn't abstract. Hype was drowning signal. Coin voting and flex culture were skewing incentives. He argued that values had to be said out loud, or the shortest-term profits would win by default. Soon the music of the bull market faded. Prices fell, attention wandered. In a few months, Ether slid from around $3,000 in April 2022 to roughly $1,000 by June 18, 2022. Headlines that once called him the youngest crypto billionaire gave way to Vitalik's own post. "I'm not a billionaire anymore." The boom-to-bust arc was public and fast. But that quiet was useful. Without the frenzy, builders could think, and Vitalik could push a bigger idea forward. His view of that moment was blunt. He understands that people who are deep into crypto, and especially building things, a lot of them welcome a bear market. To focus on the right thing without the noise around. It cleans out the hype and creates space to focus on real work. So while headlines tracked red charts, the agenda tightened. Finish the long-planned switch to proof of stake, harden the network, and ship the upgrades that actually make Ethereum better. That's the mindset that set up the merge. Change the network's engine from energy-hungry mining to stake-based validation, live, without pausing the chain. Less spectacle, more engineering. The bear market didn't end Ethereum's story. It cleared the stage so the hard things could get built next. Before we get to the merge, here's the big why behind it.
The next major milestone is what's called the merge, which is when basically the proof of work chain just stops running and all of the applications on the proof of work chain get moved over to the proof of stake chain and continue running inside of the proof of stake chain from there.
A blockchain is a shared ledger with no boss. Thousands of computers anywhere in the world are trying to agree on one history of transactions. Without agreement, you could double spend the same money, or two conflicting versions of the ledger could exist. So blockchains need a way to 1. Decide who gets to add the next block. 2. Make cheating expensive. And 3. Let everyone quickly see which chain is the real one. That decision process is called consensus, historically secured on Ethereum by proof of work. Getting the consensus through proof of work means securing the network by making participants run huge numbers of computations, burning electricity, to win the right to add the next block. It's robust but power-hungry because all that work consumes real-world energy. The merge is the moment Ethereum changed its security system, live, by replacing miners with stakers without stopping the network. With the new proof-of-stake, Ethereum will secure the network by making participants lock up value instead of mining block with computation. Validators deposit Ethereum coins and run validation software. They prove their trustworthiness not burning electricity, but putting down large amounts of money. If they follow the rules, they earn rewards. If they cheat, the protocol can automatically cut their stake, taking away the money. You've replaced an electricity bill with skin in the game, which uses far less energy for the same job. Technically, on September 15th, 2022, Ethereum's execution layer, where apps and transactions live, fused with the beacon chain, the proof-of-stake consensus layer. Mining switched off, staking took over. switching to staking slashed Ethereum's energy use by about 99.95%, a huge environmental win that also made it easier for companies and institutions to build on Ethereum without the mining footprint. The chain kept producing blocks, apps kept running, Vitalik marked it. In short, the bear market focus paid off. Less hype, more engineering, and a live security switch that positioned Ethereum for its next decade. Today, Ethereum feels alive again. Prices have climbed back. In late August 2025, Ether pushed to fresh highs near $4,950, a new record that signaled returning confidence. That rebound also put Vitalik back in the billionaire club. On-chain data firms tracked his public wallets, topping $1 billion as ETH moved above $4,000. On-chain billionaire again, just 4 years after the first time. And the ecosystem isn't just up in price, it's busy. On summer 2025, on-chain transfer volume hit a multi-year high, evidence of real usage, not just headlines. Vitalik's focus is simple to say: scale, safety, privacy. In his words, there are three major technical transitions Ethereum needs: rollups for scale, smart account wallets for usability, and privacy that works by default. He keeps pushing those forward. Investors are noticing the maturity. The merge proved the chain could change its engine mid-flight and keep running, keeping the chain open for the next wave of builders. What lies ahead for Ethereum and its founder Vitalik Buterin will surely be fascinating to discover in the years to come. But for the moment, if you enjoyed Vitalik's story, we are sure you'll find the next story as much exciting. Click on the next video to explore the next entrepreneurial journey in our Serial Entrepreneur series, right here on Vision Economy.